What is up, everyone? It is your boy Speed here, and today we're going to be doing an advanced analysis of Nine's mid Void Spirit gameplay and talking about how he wins the mid lane. I'm really going to be pinpointing just every little thing. I think what players don't realize when trying to gain MMR or when watching a professional player is every little mechanic they abuse to win the lane. They just say, oh, it's just that they have high CS and cast their spells right, correct? No! There's so many more things than that, there's so many mind games, and I'm going to be trying my best to explain all of them to you here today. So smash that like button, subscribe, and of course, go sub to Game Link down below, otherwise, you will have nightmares that I am coming to your house to destroy it because you bought mana boots in your last game of supporting. Trust me, I know you did, you can't avoid me. Also, if you guys want to get some in-depth knowledge and content, make sure you go sign up to the Game Link website. I create content there basically every single day. I've been aiming for every video every single day, like, of my own. There are other pros who create content as well, so basically you're getting one video from me every day, or a video from pro every single day, or two videos a day. And that doesn't include YouTube posts, right? It's not like we just only post our YouTube content there, right? It is up over there, but you're gonna get such good content, such in-depth stuff. I've even had someone message me on Discord recently saying, oh, Speed, I'm shocked there's so much original and content over there. I'm like, yeah, we put in a lot of work to make sure that Game Leap is not, you know, just some meme, right? I know Game Leap is literally just a meme sometimes, but it really isn't. There's so much value there. In fact, I think we could charge $50 a month for it, and I would still think it's worth it, which maybe it's just me being biased, you know, Game Leap for life, you know? But yeah, go sign up right now, click the link down below, and I hope to see you guys there. All right, so getting into the lane, there's nothing crazy about starting items. It doesn't really matter. You buy the same thing every game. If you don't go this build, well, you're crazy. However, there is one other variant in hard matchups where you don't buy the mantle. You just kind of don't buy any stats. You buy a branch, you buy a fairy fire, sometimes two branches if you're feeling spicy, and then you rush a bottle. So yeah, if you're in a difficult matchup, you can go that. But against a hero like Magnus, you don't want to do that because if you lack damage, you'll get denied. The most important and impressive thing about Nine's gameplay here is the fact that he got denied once in 5 minutes. Guys, he's against a Magnus. Do you understand how insane that is? I've played Magnus against Divine players before, and I literally get like 13 denies in 5 minutes. Alright, that's a hard flex. Sorry, don't hate me. I was just trying to make myself feel good. Alright, so first things first, the lane starts, right? Nine has a really good block. He does a fantastic job not messing up at all, and Magnus clearly just griefed this block entirely. Now, getting into this, a lot of players would say, oh, it's under my tower. And then they would 50-50 to CS. Absolutely not. So what you want to do when the wave instantly meets is pull aggro. Literally, as the melee creep touches, Nine pulls aggro, and that's what you want to do. Once this melee creep bumps into this one, you can pull the aggro. If you don't wait until that point, it's gonna mess up. So wait for them to connect, then he pulls aggro instantly. Instantly. Not when it's half HP, instantly. Why is this? It's because he knows the Magnus is obviously gonna contest it. Magnus has nothing better to do. So what he wants to do is try to pull creep aggro twice. Yes, twice. So he pulls it once here, right? And then the Magnus is like, I don't want to overextend. Now in this case, he doesn't pull it twice. He could have, if Magnus contests, he maybe could have pulled it again. Worst case scenario, he has to use this E early, which is still not the end of the world. But it's very important to note that under tower, it is good to pull creep aggro, because if you don't, you'll get denied. It's really easy to deny people when, or at least grief their CS when their wave is under tower, so you'll see Nine does it again here, right? And so anytime you're under tower, make sure you pull creep aggro to avoid getting denied. Next thing here, anytime you have a nuke to secure CS, it's brutally important to kill the range creep in a fashion that you burst it. So, this range creep is half HP, right? What he wants to do is hit it, then nuke it. You don't want to wait to nuke it or just try to last hit it against a hero like Magnus or even against a ranged hero. Okay, why against a ranged hero? Well, against a ranged hero, what's particularly strong if you kill the range creep is that these two melee creeps will start bopping them, right? The ranged hero will get destroyed by it. So you want to hit, nuke, that prevents any sort of deny, I mean, unless they're a god, right? And now the wave shoves into Magnus, which is good. Following that up, he's going to throw up a Q onto the high ground, really well placed, throws it at this sort of diagonal angle up towards the tower, catches out the Magnus, doesn't do an insane amount of damage, right? Maybe could have hit him once there, but yeah, just some good harass. And the key to winning the lane is slow and efficient trades, which we'll get into. So the next thing we need to note is another situation. Basically, this is a great rule of thumb to apply to all of your future mid games. If you are under the tower, pull aggro, right? Doesn't matter what tower you're under, you want to pull aggro, right? You want to keep the lane back. Actually, there is one exception. there's probably a few, but one that comes to mind for me is that if you're playing a ranged hero and you feel like it's easy to deny the enemy, right, like they can't contest you, maybe they're playing Invoker and they can't actually harass you, or they don't threaten you in any way, it actually can be really, really good to leave the wave under their tower and just 50-50 all the denies. That's a good strategy. But as a melee hero, it's very hard to deny under tower. It can become very risky, right? He can get potentially skewered or even just pulled back by a potential Q. He doesn't really know, right? There's no way for him to know. Instead, you just want to play it safe and pull the wave back. This also gives him a potential range creep deny. Obviously, the Magnus is a good player, doesn't let him have it, but it's a good thing to keep in mind. Next up is this range creep. So every little thing counts, right? You can't just give up a range creep deny and say, ah, it's whatever, right? There are range creeps you do have to let go, but after Magnus gets to CS, where is 9 looking? He's looking here. Most players would not have the awareness to do this. You have to train it. So he's looking back. He's paying attention. He sees the Magnus turn towards the range creep. So what does he do? He turns around, right? He's trying to read it. He knows he can clip it with his E. Now, if he doesn't have a nuke, he'd probably just let the Magnus have a deny, right? There are some heroes that you simply can't contest range creeps with because they don't have a nuke. But when you have a nuke, you want to check. Now, he sees that the Magnus fakes the CS, so he goes in a circle. Doesn't want to overcommit, right? He does not want to try to do the hit E thing, right? He doesn't want to try to burst the creep because otherwise he's going to tank a full melee creep and auto attack. So he's now just watching the Magnus, waiting for the animation, sees it, reacts, E's, gets the creep. That's a big deal. It's a lot of XP. And then finally, after he pushes in this wave here, he sees the Magnus overextends. If you're playing Lina, Leshrac, Void Spirit, any sort of hero with a disable or, you know, some way to keep someone in place, you often want to use it if they go for a deny like this, right? If they overextend when you have 4 creeps and they have 2, you want to cast your spell, right? So if I was a Lina, I would stun. If I was a Lesh, I would stun. If I'm a Void Spirit, I would Aether Remnant. So much so to the point that I actually think 9 was a bit late on this Aether Remnant. Why do I think that, guys? Why do I think 9 was slightly late on this Aether Remnant? Well, the reason is because he could have actually pulled the Magnus under tower. Now, you're probably saying, Speed, wouldn't this melee creep tank the damage? Yeah, maybe, but it was dying right here, so he could have done it like 0.2 seconds earlier just to get slightly more value, because he actually didn't pull the Magnus back under tower, when that's actually your primary goal, as, you know, the tower just does a lot of damage. It's pretty simple. The next advanced technique is a way to secure multiple creeps when going under tower. So in this case here, he pulls aggro, right? Pulls aggro, because he's under tower. Then he's going to loop around, and what he's going to do is actually pull aggro again. So he right-clicks the Magnus there. I don't know if you guys could see it, but he right-clicks the Magnus. And what this does is it brings the creep wave to him. So instead of having to walk to here to last at this, and then walk here to last at this, and likely get denied or miss one of them, he pulls this one over here, is able to secure it here, and because of that, he's now in range to get this range creep. Right, very, very clean, and now here you're likely going to see the burst the range creep strat again, as per usual. Actually, no, Magnus backs off, so he gets some value, right? Oh, that's such high awareness. I love that. Just because the Magnus was backing off, instead of hitting the range creep, he hits the Magnus, gets a little bit of value damage, and ease him up. Just such a heads-up play, and like, those are the little things that separate, you know, 9k players from even someone like a 7k player. I really do mean that. Like, that's just pure intuition, something you have to build up over time. It's basically impossible to teach that stuff. And lastly, the only thing I have to say for this first 2 minutes, first of all, I hope you guys are enjoying this. If you want to see more advanced analysis of other lanes, let me know which lane you would like to see next. But yeah, click the like button if you are enjoying. And also, you do just have to be good at last hitting. I know this is something I say a lot in my videos, but I mean it. Him having 16 last hits in 2 minutes and 45 seconds allows him to get a very early bottle, which allows him to spam his spells, harass the Magnus, and secure the CS. So make sure you're using a lot of spells in the early game as just an overall tip. 9 has casted a ton, he's used 3 bottle charges, and at the 3 minute mark is only half mana. So hopefully that kind of just goes to show how much spells pros actually use. Alright, moving on, we see a really good punish once again by 9. Let's look at the creep advantage, and really when I say creep advantage, at this point in the game, the creeps don't do that much damage to the Magnus. They're not the main factor in terms of damage, really, at this point in the game. However, they give you a really good sort of idea of when the opponent is going to retreat, right? And whenever someone is retreating, that's very often when you can catch them off guard and do a bunch of damage without getting any return damage. And that's exactly what happens here. He sees he has a slight creep advantage, actually auto-attacks the range creep to push it in, and then, after doing that, he creates this numbers advantage, right? So after you kill the range creep, which you can do at any point in the lane, you create this advantage where you have a melee creep advantage, and then you can pull the enemy into it. And he backs up, obviously, does not want to get skewered, so usually you would auto-attack in, right? When you hit, you move forward, you hit and you move forward. But in this case, he doesn't want to get skewered, so he hits and he moves backwards, hits and he moves backwards. Right here, he actually makes his first mistake, maybe not the first mistake, there's always a little stuff, right? But he makes his mistake here, slightly overextends for the range creep. He shouldn't have gone for this. He probably was just like, oh, I can contest it, but he has no spells and Yeah, it's just not a good idea to really contest Thunder Tower. So the Magnus is obviously going to man up here. He has no spells. And because he has no spells, he's going to back up. However, his spells are on a 1 second cooldown. So what does he do? He actually mans up as the spells are coming up, pops the Fairy Fire, gets the shield with the E, pops the Aether Remnant, and gets the kill with 16 health. Now he does end up going down, but that's a huge win. That's a huge, huge win. It really all started with a mistake, so, you know, it's not like that had to go down. It didn't have to be that close, really. But still, it was a great move to get the XP advantages. Magnus gets nothing because he died first. And now let's end up the episode, and I know this is kind of a short one, but I really just want to talk about the major important things that you guys can start applying in your games as soon as possible. But in this clip, we're going to see the most important and impressive... Well, I think I said that earlier. Part 2 of the most important and impressive play that 9 actually makes. And what this is an understanding of just ship damage. People are really bad at ship damage because most players feel like, oh, when they're going to go for a kill, they need to all in on it, right? They need to get it in that moment or they're not going to go for it at all. But no, this is actually a really bad idea because if you get the kill over time, you have to commit less resources, it's less risky, and yeah, that's about it. So as we see here, he hits level 6 first, which is because of the kill earlier. It's also because of the fact that he has 6 denies and only got denied once in 5 minutes, as I told you guys. And yeah, if he doesn't do all of these things, he can't make this current play. But yeah, with the stat items and the boots, he sees the Magnus going for the wave, clips him with the ulti, hits him with the E right away, gets it off cooldown, Remnant pulls him into the creep wave, and only actually starts attacking the Magnus towards the end. Gets a lot of value, right? De-aggroes the tower, resets, and that's it. A lot of players would say, what? Why not commit? The Magnus is low. It's because the Magnus isn't that low. He also has raindrops. So, with just one more astral step, he couldn't get the kill. And even if he did get the kill, it would maybe cost him his life to a Nature's Prophet TP or a Tusk TP, or even a potential, Spectre doesn't have a haunt. But it would potentially cost him his life, right? It could get him killed. That's not worth it. Instead, what he can do is just push in the wave, get his levels, he's gonna pop his mango, run into the jungle, because what else is Magnus going to do? In fact, he scanned him out, right? I mean, honestly, he could have made the prediction that Magnus is here anyway. Magnus is just, they just jungle. Even if they're low, they'll jungle. So, I mean, yeah, he runs in here. He scans it out anyway, but he probably would have done it regardless of the scan. Hits him up. Actually, hardcore messes up the Remnant. Noob! Terrible player, am I right, guys? Let's all flame 9. No, I'm kidding. But, yeah, he's able to get the Magnus, only uses the Astral Step when he's out of attack range. So very important point. I see this all the time, Void Spirits and Ember Spirits making this mistake, especially even, you know, Storm Spirits. Any hero with Sword of Mobility, you don't want to use your mobility until you're out of auto attack range, because that's how you get the most amount of auto attack. So he hits here. Well, no, he messes up his Remnant. He hits, then he uses the haste, he hits again. Then when the Magnus is sort of out of vision and out of attack range, then he uses his ulti right after the auto attack. Because that's how you maximize autos. You maximize autos with mobility spells by hitting, mobility, hitting again, right? You use the mobility when your auto attack is on cooldown. And because of that, he's able to get another attack off, pops a thing from the Magnus. The next Astral Step comes up, and that's because he waited, and he secures the kill onto one of the tankiest heroes in Dota. Trust me, guys, you will not see Void Spirits kill Magnuses frequently. It just doesn't really happen. And that's because, in order to do it, you either have to be a smurf, or you need to do every little thing that 9 has done for the past 5 minutes and 45 seconds. The creep aggro that he pulled at whatever it was, 10 seconds into the game, adds up for that kill. It does, because it gives him the items he needs, it gives him the levels he needs. Every little thing matters, and that is why it's so hard to gain MMR in Dota. Because if you don't look at the small stuff, and you don't ever come to the realization that the game is much harder or much more complex than you think, and you look at it as a surface level and just say, I think I went the wrong item build again. That's all I ever read! Why is that the only thing I ever read? That people go the wrong items! There's like a million other things you need to fix! Nah, but I hope you guys kind of get the point. There really is so many things to fix in Dota, and I hope this video sort of points that out. No, I'm not making this stuff up. I was not trying to overanalyze here. I really was only analyzing things that actually exist. I know there can be like these complex analysis analysis in videos, but this is not one of them. This is literally me pointing out every little mechanic that he's doing intentionally. So yeah, thank you guys for watching. I hope you enjoyed and I'll see ya in the next one.
Before you leave, just want to say a quick message. If you're trying to get better at Dota or you just enjoyed that video, I know this is pretty general and you're going to hear this quite a bit from me, but I recommend you sign up to GameLink.com. Why? Because I put a lot of effort into the content over there, and generally the effort I do there is different from the content you're going to see here on YouTube. It is different. In fact, I usually go a lot more in-depth on topics or into niche topics that help you get to the next level even faster, because on YouTube, I often have to keep it more mainstream. And that's even why I'm putting it at the end of this YouTube video. That's why this is at the end, because a lot of people just watch 5 minutes, they skip through just for like the dopamine spike. But if you are interested in actually getting better at Dota, I recommend you go to the description down below, get your discount right now by clicking the link, sign up, use the discount code that you're gonna see there, and I hope to see you there right now. So click it, and yeah, thanks for watching.